There are many benefits along with many challenges and opportunities to solve. I'll choose three. The first is that through digital health, we will be able to handle massive amounts of data on individuals, cohorts of like individuals, and populations. And through handling massive amounts of data on the health and wellness of individuals, we'll come up with new discoveries that will greatly add to health and disease. So relating a person's personal properties to a large database of other individuals and looking for patterns and finding the pattern that is then useful and consistent, can be validated and then used back for the person. So it's the handling of big data is the first advantage for new discovery. The second is the use of that big data, as I mentioned, for personalized medicine, that now when the individual is ill or indeed when he's well, one will advise that person of the probability of them getting certain diseases in the future based on their genome, based on their microbiome, based on their behavior, and then be able to give them a personal plan for plotting their wellness going forward, or indeed if they have an illness, be able to better stratify the disease and present a prognosis of the progression of that disease with various treatments that can be used and the benefits of that. So it'll be personalized medicine for the individual rather than treating an individual as an average of a population. And then the next benefit that I see is to lower the cost of healthcare. This will only come, in my opinion, after an initial blip of an increase in cost, because it's a new technology, it's expensive, it initially will be driven by the private sector, and after a period when the private sector pays as early adopters for this technology, it'll then come into the public sector. There may be a transitory increase in cost because it's a new technology, but then when measured over years or half decades, then costs will decline, because in the end, it's the ability to prevent disease that is more important than late on trying to treat disease. That saves so much money for the individual and for society, and is also better for them personally. So there's three benefits: handling of big data for discovery, personalized medicine to treat the person's condition for them alone, and third, to net reduce costs for them and for society. The role of biotechnology? Well, biotechnology is a term that encompasses many tools. The one that I'm most familiar with is actually whole genome sequencing. Now it's possible to sequence a person's genome for a few thousand dollars at very high accuracy and precision, and from that, for a well person, predict their probability of getting cancer later in life, the probability of cardiovascular disease, and whether, for example, they have diseases that only happen in adults from a single nucleotide change, the adult Mendeliome. So all of these things one can detect from one's genome. One can also detect your pharmacogenomic profile. So if you have certain liver enzyme variants, you are more or less able to handle different drugs, and you should have different drugs prescribed to suit your liver and your enzymes as an individual. So biotechnology, through contributing to genome sequencing, to a measuring of metabolic phenotype, measuring of microbiome, is at the center of many things, exactly like, of course, IT and artificial intelligence and handling big data. All of these things come together in digital health. Yes, as I mentioned, if you look at a person's genome, you can identify people who from birth have with them several genetic variants that, for example, increase the risk of cancer. Whereas those who do not have those particular mutations in their genome have to go through many events over years to have those oncogenic events and then have them accumulate to cause cancer. But a person who begins life where they inherit from their parents a whole bunch of genes that are already switched on to be oncogenes begins with that initial burden. If you know that you have that burden, then you can take appropriate first recognition of it and then think of steps. So, for example, with women who have potentially the BRCA genes, if you as a woman know that you have the wrong genetic the wrong genotype of BRCA, then you will even go to the extent of considering, after you've had children, a mastectomy, a hysterectomy, etc., in order to remove the almost certainty that you will have breast cancer and uterine cancer thereafter. So that's a drastic example. A more usual example would be if you had an increased risk of cancer that you could tell from your genome, rather than waiting until you're 50 to have your first colonoscopy, and then the next one in 5 years, and then 2 years, and 2 years, etc., for the rest of your life. And a reminder, colonoscopy is the most successful diagnostic procedure for preventing a cancer risk for colon cancer. You might, if you had high risk, have your first colonoscopy at 30, and then every 5 years. And so that would be worth the extra money to that individual to have that investment in diagnosis at a faster rate than normal. So yes, we can look at a person's risk of disease. I would say in the next 10 to 15 years, we will have sorted out the genes that predispose to complex diseases, autoimmune disease, to obesity, to diabetes and metabolic syndromes. When we have that sorted out, we'll be able to tell a person when they're 15 or 20, here is your potential path for this chronic disease. And if you take certain activities in the next 10 years, if we watch you very carefully, we will be able to either prevent that or delay it.